niisama.
Mida me ole kuulnud?
Esimene päev. Mina ärkanud asjaga näen, et mingi hall vanas liikub üle aia. Murrab pooled kanad
lammud.
Normaalne. A järgmine päev tuleb soliidne saksane. Aa, minu kunds. Kogemata, vabandage. Kas ta üle jääb elus lood ära?
Ei müü.
Kulli. A tema vanker, mis liigub kõige.
Intriguing in so many ways, hopefully. My name is Indrek, and I'm here as a professor at the Digitisation School, Media Arts and Communication School these days. And I'm also head of this Media Innovation and Digital Venture Research Center that actually organized this wonderful conference today. And as a kind of representative of my institutions, we will continue surprising you with these little productions of our own students. And perhaps, I also saw it first time now, perhaps what this introduces really is on the one hand how hard it is, actually how much work goes into the mediation process of cultural history, and perhaps also how the technology was there is. And even that the possibility that, you know, the cross-broader interpretations of the, you know, European history, because essentially that is an old Dutch painting that was right now, a couple of years ago, reinterpreted, the story was reinterpreted by the Estonian film students. So, and I hope this kind of already illustrates what we are about to do in this panel.
And what I also realized earlier today is that this is the panel where we have all professors here today. And let's start out from here. One of our distinguished guests is Professor Andrew Hoskins from the University of Glasgow. Welcome. And then comes here next Professor Peter Stockinger from... I can't do the French pronunciation of your institution.
Institut National de Langue et Civilisation Orientale.
As a short version goes.
National Institute of Oriental Languages and Civilizations. And the Estonian is taught in our university. Uh-huh. So.
Yes, I realize this also, actually, also, yeah. And yeah, also known as INALCO, for those people, a wonderful and very famous institution. And then comes Professor Marju Lauristin, who is professor at Tartu University in Estonia, our biggest and the oldest university, but also is a member of the European Parliament and has special relevance here in this context because, as she mentioned herself in the previous panel, was the rapporteur for the recently adopted European data protection regulation. And Monika Hagedorn-Saupe comes from Germany, works in the Museums Research Institute that is part of a very big institution called Berlin State Museums, if I'm saying it right. And the sort of order of the panel is, as was the previous one, we will start out with the slightly longer interventions, where we can, when our participants will be telling their initial viewpoints, and then we continue the conversation between us and later open for a discussion to the audience. So let's kick it off. Andrew, floor is yours.
Thank you. Can you hear me okay? I've got a terrible cold, so apologies for that.
You can hear me now. Indrek, thank you so much for inviting me and putting together such a wonderful conference. I want to say something about the research I've been conducting over the past couple of years into cultural and organisational memory. Cultural and organisational memory of the British Army and how the digital transforms their official records. Just a bit of context, if I may. These operational records are sent back from the field of battle to the Ministry of Defence on a monthly basis. They used to be called war diaries and have been recorded since 1907. And the reason for this was prompted by errors in the Second World War in the hope of keeping an archive of past engagements that the military would avoid making similar mistakes in the future. And these records are collected and archived and managed by a few historians called Army Historical Branch. And so I undertook an ethnographic study of them and their archive in Whitehall in London. And they provide impartial analysis to support British Army and policymakers, military planning, decisions, and accountability. And today there's a kind of a chain of memory organizations that are linked in the travel of these operational records. The first is from the field to Army Historical Branch, who collate and archive these records. And then they go on to Defence Business Services, a part privatised management manager of records. And I think the part privatisation or the privatisation of records is a really key issue for this conference. And then eventually, after 20 or 30 years, into the public domain, into our national archives, the UK's official government archive. So at stake here is how war is seen or not seen, how it's accepted or contested, how it's imagined, planned for, and fought, and of course, how it's remembered and forgotten. And I just want to raise three issues in my research that I think important and relevant for wider debates on European data management. The first is that what I call the digitally fostered values of open access have some unfortunate consequences. And of course, these values, as we know, are shaped by unbridled commentary, confessional culture, the immediacy of instant search, open access, freedom of information. And these shape what and when once classified records are released into the public domain. So in the UK, our policy is founded upon the 1958 Public Records Act that established a 30-year rule as the time when all government departments have to review their records. But our digital culture of openness has helped force legislation through, reducing this 30-year rule to a 20-year rule. And one of the consequences of this change and the part privatisation of records is that there's been over-destroying. So plenty of files that I would argue have great cultural and historical value have been destroyed. And this is by putting pressure on the throughput of records at the time, of course, great organisational and economic change. And I really believe that faster history is not necessarily better history. Secondly, and a quick point, the strength of organisational memory is adversely affected through records being treated as low priority in organisational food chains. And there are many people here who can talk more eloquently to that than I can from their experience, often as an afterthought rather than as intrinsic to the business. For instance, during the 2000s, under pressure of economic recession, the British Civil Service cut hundreds of E-grade administrators. These are the experts in filing and storage and retrieval. So, you know, the very mechanism for ensuring the effective creation and collation and maintenance of accessible records has been fundamentally weakened. My third point is on the consequences, and some of the consequences of the complexity and the volume of digital records. The recent Iraq and Afghanistan wars marked the evolution of the military defense organizational memory system from paper to digital. Although the organization was using computers in 2001, it was still operating, like many civil servants, a paper system, printing out work and placing it in files. And this compares, of course, with the several hundred million digital files from operation in Iraq and Afghanistan it has to manage today. It's a completely different world. And all governments will have to deal with the challenge of how to conduct what's known as sensitivity review, reviewing classified records to make a decision as to whether records should be destroyed, retained, or left in the, released in the public domain. And my question is, well, what form of human assessment by those with deep historical and security knowledge of this digital accumulation will ever be possible? For instance, emails are increasingly a standard component of archives, certainly a standard component of the operational record, from which the moments of critical decision-making can be pinpointed. And emails are just one example of the digital archive where, of course, the personal and the official are blended together, as with Hillary Clinton's use of her personal email server to handle classified information. And for me, it's hard to imagine how the classified, the secret, and the personal will ever be disaggregated in some form that will enable them to be released and used, put in a usable form in the public domain. And in terms of sensitivity review of official records, I found in terms of the UK government that risk appetite is diametrically opposite of the most optimistic view of what the technology could do. So to briefly conclude then, what we have here is a perfect storm of technological, political, cultural change sweeping across the archival change of UK operational records, which is ultimately weakening military organizational memory structure, as well as diminishing a significant basis of our national history of warfare. And for me, it's only through taking these things together, and we've heard bits and pieces across this throughout the day so far, taking these things together, the technological, the cultural, and the political, how these changes together and over time, that we can gain an effective understanding of the challenges for data management and for cultural and organizational memory and their changes and their consequences. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And perhaps, Peter, you continue.
Thank you very much, Indrek, for this very kind invitation. My small speech will be very general. I will try to develop some general ideas about digital archives and cultural identity. And I will, in relationship to something what is called by scholars the meaning economy, something what is growing out from the knowledge economy. And in this sense, I will advocate a very broad understanding of digital archives and cultural identity, cultural diversity, which doesn't really fit with the dominant institutional discourse we have already heard this morning. Now, let me come to the notion of meaning economy. What can we understand under this label of meaning economy? One of the central themes that characterize this kind of new economy is the production and consumption of data and objects which reflects or express, or again, stage our personal and collective experiences, emotions, expectations, desires, fears, beliefs, truth, or knowledge. Keywords and examples of this economy are, for instance, multisensory communication, landscape as brainscape, immersive multimodal 3D and 4D textscapes and allospheres, object and data tailored to individual desires and needs, co-creation of objects and data by users and consumers, smart, intelligent, and semantically meaningful self-assembling and linking objects and data animation, what we have seen just before So this is a very nice image which has been animated. So in a nutshell, meaning economy seems to be based on the principles of an outer, sensible and perceptible world of data and objects, which stages the inner mental emotional world of a person or of a collective agent. Now, giving this kind of general description or characterization of meaning economy, let me try to introduce now the notions of digital archives and cultural diversity and see how this fit with this meaning economy. Archive or digital archives means basically, as we know, the selection, the storage, and the preservation of data, written, spoken, visual, audiovisual, real objects, and so on. However, a more complete vision of archives would add at least four other dimensions. First, the storage and the preservation is regulated. There are always explicit, or at least tacit, norms and rules to be respected. Second, there are not only data in an archive, but also, as we know, metadata for identifying, describing, commenting, enriching, linking data, and so on. So we have now actually a lot of metadata versions of archives, metadata archives without data which belong to the metadata archive. Third, an archive includes also a series of processes of how to store data, of how to access them, of how to read them, of how to interact with them, of how to reuse and to exploit them, and so on. And finally, and for me it's the most important point, archives form the central part of a social and cultural ecosystems. In other words, and metaphorically speaking, archives constitute, so to speak, the brain of which the body is a personal or collective social and cultural ecosystem. So the ecosystem of which an archive constitutes, so to speak, the brain, is a collectivity of actors, of persons, communities, institutions, social movements, and so on, who share what? A pool of meaning, or in other words, a pool of experiences, values, beliefs, evidences, truths, fixed ideas, knowledge, and so on. And such a collectivity of actors indeed functions as a society in a traditional sense. Such a collectivity of actors cooperate for maintaining this pool of meaning, for enriching it, for transforming it in contact with other cultural ecosystems, and also for defending it against outer or inner menaces. Good examples for such meaning ecosystems are, in my opinion, the today's social media platforms. For instance, YouTube hosts actually millions of channels, and each channel forms a small, ephemeral, more or less long-lasting social and cultural ecosystem of which the brain is an archive, broadly speaking, of shared data and metadata, of processes and of rules. Now, let me come quickly to the notion of cultural diversity and identity. Cultural ecosystems basically are therefore meaning producing, sharing and consuming communities of actors that possess in the center an archive where meaning in form of data and metadata is stored and processed. And this in fact leads us to understand that we are facing at least two different forms of cultural diversity. One is traditional cultural diversity represented by, for instance, the national cultures, the religious cultures, the linguistic cultures, the ethnic cultures, social cultures like political cultures and so on. And we know that the archives are playing an extremely important central role for these cultures. They have a memory function, identity function, a function for learning and processing and so on. But we're also facing actually a very different cultural diversity, which is composed of brand and consumer cultures, of lifestyle cultures, of personal cultures, or again of social organizational cultures. And all these cultures, in fact, functions like national cultures, like linguistic cultures, They have their meaning processing systems, and they have in the center an archive, which in fact constitutes or has as a basic function to maintain a memory, to create an identity, to defend this identity, and also to process and to enable the processing of learning and teaching. So this is a very general vision of digital archives, which I try to defend also in my works and also in my research works in Europe. So thank you.
Really, I think I don't need it as I have the other tool to convey my message. And as it was said, my everyday job in Parliament is connected with data protection, but I will not speak about data protection. I will speak about the research we are doing in university in Tartu, and our interest is in the cultural communication and in the transfer of cultural knowledge between social groups in society or between societies, between ethnical groups, between generations, etc. And we can look at all this problem of digitization of the cultural heritage from different viewpoints. We can have this archive-centered viewpoint, but we can also have the customer-centered viewpoint. And I think that it's very important that we will not forget about people, about customers or producers, however we call them. Today we have a very important day in Estonia. We have day of opening of the new building or really new ecosystem of our cultural heritage institution. That's the National Museum, new building of National Museum in Tartu. And I have to say that our institute had three doctorate students who were preparing this new environment, including new digital environment, and three doctoral dissertations made in preparation of this event, opening of new National Museum. And the aim namely was to understand the role of this kind of National Museum in the intercultural communication, because as it was said in previous panel, Estonia is so small, there are so few people, you even cannot speak about big data in Estonia. Though we think that for that, it is very important that our National Museum will become center of intercultural communication, though that we can transfer our cultural heritage, our cultural knowledge to people from other cultures. And when I asked from Philip Schlesinger, our keynote speaker, about the issue what we have doing cultural studies, when we look at the cultural realities and then conflicts which are rising with migrants and then between minorities and so on, though how we can really use our knowledge in this new situation and how we can use it in this digital environment, then we come to a very important thing. We already have learned to use this kind of technical language. We talk about interoperability, we talk about portability, and that's all very relevant, but we have to understand that there is also cultural interoperability and cultural portability. And that should be one of the challenges for digitalization, because digitalization means also really cultural recoding. And we come here to the very, very general notion of translation. It is translation. It's translation from one codification system to other, from one medium to other, and also from one culture context to the other, even if it's not linguistic, even if it's audiovisual. You said, it's well-known painting, European painting, and now... But if Chinese people will look at that, they don't have a clue about the context of the painting. Though if Chinese will be looking at our National Museum, at our folklore, our patterns, and so on, how they can have this clue how to understand, how to put this new message digitized, all portable, interoperable in technical way, in the context of their culture, that need to have some interface, have to have some very different the different element in all this process of digitization, which is connected with this usage and user profiles. And in our studies, what we have now done on the Estonian level, we have focused now in the latest years, namely on this so-called digital shift in culture transfer. And what we can say in a very, very brief and then general way, we can see that, I suppose, in each of our countries, the population really could be looked very roughly as divided by five different options. If we take as one dimension the digital skills and not having digital skills, and other dimension having cultural skills and not having cultural skills, then we can have people who are rich and resourceful in both. They are digital pioneers, but culturally well informed. And they very easily, they surf from one environment to other, in one ecosystem culture to other. They go to museum, they go to IT labs, they go to university, they go to startup, and then that's very easy for them. Then we have other part who are digitally informed and skillful, but culturally not informed. More and more young people, more and more young people. They can do everything digitally, but they don't have a clue of the meaning, culture meaning of what they're doing. Then we have the other option. We have people who are culturally well educated, but digitally absolutely helpless. And for them, this new digital environment is something which is alien and even really fearful. And then we have the last option, which is the most, say, unhappy, who don't have not digital skills, but also neither any cultural skills. And they are those who are left more and more in darkness in this new situation. And what is very sorry to look at, it's not only old, undereducated people, what we had before, it's more and more also young people who are really fallen out of both. And now, if we have this knowledge, what we can do when we, for example, construct or really create in practice this new memory institution, our new museum, a new library, a new archive, then I suppose we shouldn't look only at this first group who is already skillful, knowledgeable, and can make the biggest use of that. From our side, I suppose we are obliged to look at those who are digitally skillful, and they have to be brought to the culture. But also we have to help those who are culturally knowledgeable, but they are helpless in digital world. And then the most important challenge is how to bring in through these institutions, which are containing really elements of traditional culture, which are known for everybody, from the lullaby songs, from the fairy tales, from the everyday traditions, how we can bring them through that, the basic knowledge, step by step, to the level they can communicate with others in the new environment. And that's why I'm also asked about this digital opportunities. And now I come to the last word to the present situation in Europe. It's also relevant when we concern the migrants, when we concern the refugees. They really, very big part of them belong to this last group, even if they have higher education. But in this European environment, they belong to last group. And digital solutions here could be the most effective. How to bring them into this new cultural environment so that they will not be helpless, fearful, aggressive, and so on. And looking in Brussels, for all people who are dealing with all this new digital single market, everything, I still haven't seen anybody who is taking this challenge on board and taking that seriously. And one reason is because maybe there is not enough knowledge, not enough knowledge created by us, created by the cultural studies, created by political studies, so that it could be implemented for that. But I have to say, who already have taken something of that on board? Google already are creating apps for migrants and refugees. So I suppose we have here opportunity also to not only to confront, but also to learn something from these big commercial systems who are really very flexible and quick in grasping new opportunities. Thank you.
Thank you.
So I would like to give you a short glimpse about a study which we have conducted about notions of identity, belonging, and the role of cultural heritage and the impact digital cultural heritage can have on the identity building processes within European communities. The purpose of the Riches Project, where this was part of, was to analyze aspects of change brought about by digital technologies. Their changes affect every part of society, including the areas in which cultural heritage is made, held, collected, curated, and exhibited. Cultural heritage has enormous potential in terms of improving the quality of life, understanding the past, assisting territorial cohesion, driving economic growth, and most importantly, learning about our own identity and understanding who we are. With the project, we did a study on identity on community building, European identity, belonging, and the role of digital cultural heritage. Researched minority communities from UK, Italy, Germany, the Netherlands to find out how cultural heritage influences their feeling of belonging. And cultural heritage is of central importance when it comes to constructing identity. Cultural heritage can help to promote diversity, mutual understanding, dialogue, and identity. We asked people what makes them feel or not feel European. Here are some of the statements we collected. In our research, we found out that also local communities are very important to all our interviewees. Also, a strong feeling of belonging to Europe does exist, which is why we wanted to learn more about how these feelings of belonging to Europe came about. What can we learn from the research? Improving multilingual access and multilingual content is necessary. There is a need for better mediation and contextualization of content, as well as further participation offers. And raising awareness and strengthening the use of thematic technologies and linked data should be done, as well as more effort in digital curation is required to improve public access to various forms of cultural expressions. We conducted case studies among six selected European communities to learn more about the role of digital cultural heritage for identity building processes. We analyzed their digital practices to find out how these communities strengthened their identities and fostered a sense of belonging to their home countries. And I will present now some of the findings from the case study conducted with a Spanish-speaking community in Berlin. This is very diverse, as they share a common language, but come from different countries, from Spain and Latin America, and have thus different traditions, values, and histories. Our research was divided in three main topics: the analysis of the community's digital interaction habits and strategies, the examination of the community's understanding of cultural heritage, the research on the relations between Spanish-speaking community and the German mainstream culture. Here are some facts and figures about the Spanish-speaking community in Germany and Berlin, but I will not go more in detail here. We asked our interviewees about the communication channels most frequently used by them. Not surprisingly, social media was mentioned as the number one means of communication by all our interviewees. But also diasporic media play an important role when it comes to communicating with community members in Berlin. Our interviewees also get news about their home country and information about community-related events from websites designed by migrants for migrants. Our case study showed that the digital cultural heritage practice of the Spanish-speaking community in Berlin are high sociable. Especially living media was preferred by all of them. Due to its strong social character, digital technologies strengthen a feeling of belonging to the community members' home country when other means of cultural contact are not possible. Besides, digital cultural heritage practices have the potential to support the specific cultural identity of every single community member. Whether Spanish-speaking community members consume German mainstream culture or not is mostly dependent on their personal interests and language skills. The community's diasporic media offers a wide range of information on German culture and cultural events. These pages enable members to better understand German mainstream culture and even participate in events. However, the German mainstream cultural heritage also has little influence on the community's heritage, whereas personal contact with members of the mainstream culture, education systems, as well as laws and rules of conduct are more influential. What conclusions can we draw from this case study? With the help of digital technology, Spanish-speaking migrants in Berlin are living dual lives, participating actively and simultaneously in different geographies, consuming and participating virtually in many aspects of their culture abroad. Digital technology supports the communication and networking within the community and strengthens the feeling of group identity. This identity does not resemble the former cultural identity of the people back in their homelands. A new kind of new identity emerges, that of being part of the Spanish-speaking migrants group in Berlin. So digital technologies can be seen as a tool to bridge distances in the people's minds, strengthening considerably the feeling of belonging, catering for cultural consolidation, and translocal communication. Our study on European identity and digital cultural heritage has shown that cultural heritage can help to bring people of different backgrounds and nationalities together, foster engagement among these individuals, and create communities of culture. Digital technologies can be seen as the key to further unlock and make available Europe's rich cultural heritage. Innovative technologies and new ways of storytelling can and will help to foster a greater awareness of people's specific cultural expressions. If we keep in mind that the use of semantic technologies and linked open data is just as important as the availability of multilingual content and a well-thought-out curation of this content, I think we are on the right way. Thank you very much.
Thank you for the.
Is it working?
Thank you for the very intriguing sort of initial power talks, as we were saying these to be. I was just thinking that maybe I jump back now, so jump back to Philip's keynote, and you know where one of his concerns was that. There's been always the kind of policy aim in Europe to understand each other better and develop, for instance, audiovisual media policy framework that would facilitate films and content to travel between countries and so that we do understand each other better, perhaps, culturally, and develop this mutual understanding of our shared cultural history, shared cultural memory. But Philip's concern was that this is kind of falling apart these days for various reasons, somehow related to the ongoing crisis, and the nature of the crisis has been constantly changing as well. And now the title of our panel is the cultural memory, the digital mediation of the cultural memory, and it possibly affecting the sort of the forms and the evolution of the cultural memory. But actually, I'm going back to my own rationale here. What are we discussing in a sense that if we are concerned about the cultural memory, then what are we really concerned here about? Is it the national memory? Is it the European memory? Is it possible? Can it be connected? So maybe we can go back to the square one and sort of address what is the concern here, really. Who wants to start? Yeah.
Because really that is a very big concern, and we have to answer these questions. And Now I go even further back to the problem of privacy and the privacy protection and the basic human rights. And the basic human rights, they really have a presumption that human being is something of a value, that we have to protect personality. But what is a personality? Personality really is a cultural entity. Personality is not biological. It's personality is a cultural entity. And if we have to protect personality, personal privacy, personal choice, that it already have this cultural component of not only European, but global, human culture, then certainly it's always in certain language, having some this cultural, national cultural part. Even as I understand, UK is very much concerned that this English we are talking is really harming UK's cultural identity, because that's not this cultural language, which is the basic of the say, English or British or whatever identity. And then we have this more specific local community component, and then we have our private, personal, biographical one. And what is really the issue here is what you said, the storytelling. So how we tell the story about ourselves and how far we go, far in time and far in space when we talk and think about ourselves. And what now is a problem, I suppose, is that with this fragmentation and the cultural diversity which is coming from outside, there is a more and more tendency not to talk about long stories and not to go too far, because as the world is seemingly going global, borderless, then bubbles are emerging. Self-protection in bubbles and self-protection from past. Past could be harmful and different. And here, what I think, and then people who are doing this kind of heritage work also, they're thinking that it is really very harmful, because it is really making personality helpless concerning all kind of manipulation, concerning all kind of games, be these consumer games, marketing games, political games, and so on, because only this kind of embeddedness can give personality the self-confidence to form own understanding, own choice. Now, that's about freedom. All these things we're talking about, it's not about, say, something which is abstract culture. It is about the personality, it's about the personal freedom, it's about the personal capacity to make choices, personal capacity to build identities. And then that's why we have to preserve heritage. And this situation, what you described, I completely agree, what you very nicely showed, that more and more personalities, more and more people are under cross pressure of different cultures. And here this what I thought of translation and this interoperability of culture is becoming part of the cultural effort of personality. And we have to help with digital, say, tools, digital ecology to cope with that.
Yes, also yeah. About skills, I think.
There
are skills needed, and also I think we have to think about the education. There have to be some changes nowadays, yeah, in order to really allow young people to understand their culture now. And I agree fully with these groups you made, that there are more and more people who they don't have the cultural education, and they don't have the digital. So it's getting wider. It's even getting wider. And there we need to do something about, I think.
Do you want to respond?
I wonder where forgetting comes into this. We talk about memory and cultural memory. It's very easy to talk about memory. We have a whole language of metaphors and a whole lexicon of memory, but the whole very notion of forgetting is so hard to put into terms. We don't have a history of talking about forgetting. And I think that's really critical when we upload and put and rely so much on our digital technologies in a whole array of ways, individually, culturally, socially, nationally, internationally, for an understanding and a continuity of the past. And forgetting is also, I think, pertinent to an argument in another key way, and that is, as a kind of certainly like an academic community, there's a tremendous amount of forgetting about just how rapid and how fast the world has changed. And I think we have an amnesia about late 20th century media and how different the world was then. And so we have a whole new generation of people grappling with the changes that we have now without that historical knowledge of that technological and cultural transformation. And so I think that's a problem for us, I think, in terms of grappling with the problem. We have an amnesia about the rapidity of the transformations that we're trying to grapple with. And I think that's really difficult.
I would follow up from that. In the previous panel, what was discussed a lot was the kind of transparency. We need to understand who controls our data, or having ourselves more control over that data. Perhaps the whole data trade should be altogether more transparent, et cetera, et cetera. All these operations should be more transparent. But what about the forgetting, the whole preservation logic? Because this is usually not discussed in these contexts, because everybody's interested in more access, more reuse, et cetera, et cetera. But sort of the deep issues of how things are being preserved, where, and very much the logic you describe in the case of the UK military, that there are these logics in power there, in place, in work there, that we have no clue of. And should these processes be become maybe more standardized, more regulated, should more transparent?
I'm a skeptic. Actually, you can tell I'm a skeptic. I don't know what difference that ultimately would make. I think we've already gone past the point where so many of our digital traces are in the hands of so many different organizations and people, and controlled and owned and manipulated and shared. And a lot of that is very functional and very sociable and very cultural. But at an organizational level, it's very hard to, again, this is about imagining the world, the pre-digital world, to get a grasp on just what we've given up, you know, what we have already lost in terms of our everyday engagement online with a whole array of digital devices. And so I'm a real skeptic in the sense that we need to look at this with a much greater clarity of historical vision of what has changed. I mean, transparency, what good would that make ultimately in terms of retrieving, if you like, what has already been not lost, but shared and given away? I think this comes down to the debate earlier on about digital literacy and media literacy. You know, to some extent, we do have a lost generation that had very little understanding of what digital engagement meant for them. And for them, it's hard to imagine coming back to imposing a kind of an individual control again on one's own personality, biography online, and how that's meshed up in good and bad ways. So I guess I'm a real skeptic there.
I think that here are two sides of the same story. One is about remembering, and then having opportunity to remember, meaning having also opportunity to store. Because if you don't have opportunity to store and to preserve, then we cannot have any guarantees for any kind of remembering. And then there is other side is right for forgiveness, for right to be forgotten, because in our everyday communication, we really very much rely on that. We know that, you understand the situation. I didn't mind that, you know. I said that not meaning anything serious. Oh, yes, I understand your situation. But in digital situation, we don't have this kind of contextual explanations. And therefore, in this privacy protection regulation, we discussed a lot about this right to be forgotten. One thing is right to store and rules for storage and rules for retention, but other is right to be forgotten, or meaning really individual right to intervene if he discovers that something which is not relevant, not truthful about him is stored and somebody else could have this, say, false or biased knowledge and use it against him or despite his reluctance. Though I suppose that is a very, very relevant discussion. And really, what is the miracle of digitation, by the way? It's that it is really problematizing issues which seem so self-evident in our everyday communication. We have to start from scratch and understand what is the memory, what is really data, what is a culture, and I suppose that's a very good thing.
And how do you define memory anyway? Cultural memory is for me, it's a matter of individual and social practices that shape a particular orientation to the past based upon present-day concerns. So, you know, it's that very active notion of memory, not a matter of storage. It's about engagement in the present with a set of circumstances through a set of practices which produces cultural memory.
Yeah, but the active practices, they are really, they have to be trained. And that is what you said about the skills and about all this, the active ecosystems, because if young people don't have any kind of training, then they're afraid even to touch this old and complicated and ununderstandable big amounts of texts and events and histories, because it seems for them so complex and so far away.
Important point is also what people are doing with the data. So, this means what is called, so in a general label, the remediatization of data, so the rewriting of data. This means, for instance, if you take a YouTube channel in which, for instance, you have reportages stored, and these reportages are recontextualized, and this recontextualization, in fact, creates very new information, new meaning, but a meaning which is attuned to the small community which constitutes an ecosystem. For instance, we are actually studying YouTube channels about racist, fascist, anti-immigrant communication. So, and there are at least, 100, 150 channels which in fact use data, audiovisual data, and this audiovisual data only can be either taken, the data from news channel, for instance, CNN or something like this, or BBC and so on, and these videos are only recommended changed from in the soundtrack, something like this, or an off, how do you say, voix off of an well, like commentary from somebody and so on. And in fact, that is what is very interesting here, that you create a really very new meaning universes, in fact. And this and it's also another thing, it's also with the memory function. I think it's not so much a problem, in my opinion, what you store, but in fact, how do you use the data in order to recreate, to rewrite, as Michel de Certeau has told it, to rewrite your history. And your identity, your personal identity or your group identity. And this, I think, is what is much more important, that what the people, how to appropriate the data and what they are doing with this data.
In this context, I would kind of follow up what was already, what was discussed in the previous panel, that this clear separation between the usage data as the big data and then sort of the cultural content as being something separate. But historically, cultural content has always been accommodated some metadata, description of what is there so that we understand the content better. And that my argument would be that the separation increasingly is not so clear between the usage data and the content, because increasingly they get intertwined. They are essentially both forms of metadata, and you know, all these analytic mechanisms are integrating both to understand better
what is the content? I mean, I guess the big question for YouTube would be actually also that, can it somehow discover sort of the racist content in these particular channels? But my concern is kind of trying to connect the different dots here. I mean, the right to be forgotten and storing in the database, but not being able to find that stuff. I mean, you've been studying YouTube a lot, and there is evidence that even if memory institutions are storing their collections on YouTube, any user cannot. There's a very good chance that you cannot find those things because the algorithms are so specific. They rely on the specific metadata there, and it even in, when we're talking about the sort of the whole of Europe and mutually understanding each other better, there is evidence that some content I can access here in Estonia, but if I would go to Sweden, I cannot, because YouTube decides that this is not relevant for you, potentially. And therefore, I guess I would now turn to Marju and ask, we actually argued, we had a discussion before the panel already, that you know this need to translate, and for the sort of to enable this kind of inter-community connections, etc. Can this be automated, or is it impossible, or how do you see it? Where should be, if it is to be automated, then where should be sort of the focus?
There are very different layers, because at first, the second institutional presumption in European Union now is that we need this digital single market, which will include also whole digital content. We are just working on new directive, and I am rapporteur on the opinion from our LIBE, the Human Rights Committee, on that, on contracts on digital content. In the first article, there is a definition of digital content. And you can say in one word what it means: everything which is digital. Starting from music and ending with software, it's all digital content. And we have now the border of the digital content even shifted further, because we're also discussing about Internet of Things, and is Internet of Things then, will it be under this directive, or it will be under directive of tangible goods? And we are coming, or Commission is coming, to understanding that also if you have a fridge, with this smart core, a smart fridge, then this software side will be digital content, what it is really. So digital content in this very blurred idea. And our understanding when we are coming from semiotics or cultural studies of content is absolutely different. And they cannot be put together even. So that is a very important issue. And for that, we need to understand that there are different layers. What you mentioned already was metadata. Yes, metadata. But then there is other thing. If now we look at the culture universals, look at grammars, look at culture grammars, look at that discourses, which are quite so the universal discourses across cultures in different languages, but really same discourses. If you look at the folklore, the standardized elements. So we have already in cultural studies, in semiotics, a lot of work done to discover those elements, those layers, which could be helpful in the whole process of digitization. Know that it will not be just technical problem, it will be cultural process. And that was my major statement, that it is not the technical process, it's a cultural process. Digitization of heritage, it's just not problem of technology, it's problem of cultural recoding, cultural translation.
That's something we have to pay attention to, because the first aim of the whole digital single market is the profit making, supporting the industry, and yeah, that's something where we have this. There is a diplomatic point to see how far does it make sense, and where, in a way, it really needs cultural heritage sector. The institutions need to retreat a little bit.
Yeah, well, I can open up a secret of institutional, say, relationship inside the parliament. We have committees which are dealing with the market side, and committees which are dealing with cultural side and with human rights side. Leading committee was appointed as a committee dealing with market and economy. And we, from side of culture committee and human rights committee, we are fighting to have word to say and to take lead in some issues. For example, when you look at the copyright, and when you look at the, all those things like the cultural heritage and so on, then clearly that cannot be left to the market logic. Yeah. And then that's what we try to achieve. So please help us.
Yeah. I just realized that I've been a very bad moderator, and it's really the time to open up the floor for the questions from the audience. So, here, please. Can Snezana get the microphone?
Thank you very much. I was attracted very much by what Marju said, but I have a question for entire panel. I completely agree with I'm very, very attracted with your division, you know, when you explained about really people being totally left, the fourth group of people being totally left, and out of both digital and culture. And I wanted to just mention that we had organized the European Union, the Council of Europe organized together with the European Union, with social innovators and with migrants. We organized a conference to see what, from digital perspective, what could be done to help this cultural translation, as you say, decodification or whatever. Unfortunately, what we realized in this conference was that somehow there is no new kind of paradigm from social innovators' side, you know, from people from technology, even from refugees. They are interested in very hands-on, very technical things, you know, that they help themselves. Culture seems to be an identity, seems to be something that comes after. And then also you mentioned that Google is already coming with apps, et cetera, et cetera. Obviously, for Google, there is a driving force. That's income, I should say. Commercial, at least, driving force. But my question to you and to the panel is, because that's also one of the outcomes of this conference, what needs to be done? What can be done, in a way? What the governments, we are governments and intergovernmental structures, we are somehow running after the events, you know. So what I would like to see, what is the driving force that could help us, and what can we undertake in order to speed up of the process of this translation, you know, cultural translation? What can be done? That's for entire panel. Thank you.
Can I start? I think it always has to do with individuals and with persons as well. We cannot expect that the digital world is solving this problem for us. We have just one example. One of our museums in Berlin, they organized, they trained refugees in order to guide their colleagues, other refugees, through the exhibition, so helping them to understand, because they are also, as you said, they are also in a foreign culture, so they don't know, it's not their culture where they are now. So help them to understand where they are now, but also at the same time bring them together with people from our culture who understand them. So we have a lot of these activities, and it was rather successful, and it ended up that, and it's still continuing, and it ends up in continuous meetings and activities between those who came there for the first time to be guided and brought together. And I have several other examples of this kind as well. Digital technologies help us to communicate this, make it possible, but it's not. From my point of view, I don't see that the digital environment itself would solve that.
here I maybe have more more hopes connected with digital environment, namely concerning these refugees and migrants, especially refugees, because when we imagine that there are millions of people, there will be more than a million of people who are around Europe, but very big part of them still in the camps, in the hotspots, in this really terrible situation. Their only window to the normal world is that they have smartphones. And smartphones have very, very important part of their everyday environment. And I can bring you very interesting examples from Sweden, what was shared with us. Sweden decided that they have very big amount of migrants. They created really app. It was done by a small firm, private firm, but it was really commissioned by the government. The app which really enabled at first to have basic knowledge about Swedish system, of labor market, basic rules, basic laws, then basic points of access. Then basic points to access education, retraining systems. But from other side, give the migrant opportunity to share his information about his skills, his background, and so on. And these really apps were installed in the simple smartphones which were given by government to each refugee which is arriving in Sweden. It looks like a fairy tale. But really, it could be imagined that for these people who are there in those terrible places, if they will have basic knowledge about Europe, about European, the basic cultural, legal aspects, basic things which help them to compare their, for example, traditions, even of food or something other, with the general or traditional European ones, give knowledge about the opportunities, how to access labor markets. So these kind of things, they could be part of this new cultural environment, which will them the way how to translate their experience into this new situation. And then if they will have also opportunity to communicate through that to the institutions in Europe. So I suppose we have to understand that also if you look at Africa, in many, many countries also, the digital window is only window which really help to synchronize the everyday life of people there with the life we have in Europe.
But the content has to come from somewhere.
Yes,
I agree that
absolutely. Content, so, yeah. Production of content is a key.
Yeah,
is a key.
Yeah.
Yes, I can complete that with you. I think that you have quoted a competence which, in my opinion, is really a key competence in this context. It's the mediation that. Digital, but also cultural mediation. And so the point is that we have not really a very good reflection about what is cultural mediation.
Mm-hmm.
Everywhere
you are
teaching in the
absolutely.
Universities cultural mediation, intercultural mediation, also in our university, and also even the head of the school of this. But we have big problems to understand well and operationally what to teach and how to define already this kind of competence of this métier,
mm-hmm.
and what content to give in this key competence.
Yeah.
So I think this could be really a thing for Europe to enhance. What is in mediation, and also what content to mediate?
Yeah.
You are exactly right. If you want to mediate, we have projects ongoing with immigrants in Calais. It's a very well-known place. But if you mediate there, I don't know, national history or national art history, it's not relevant. But what's more relevant is the knowledge, legal knowledge, how to make your path in the daily life in France and so on.
I will have a small remark on that. I suppose the very basic could be to have comparative analysis of Quran and Bible. And make it in a very simple way, so that it will be understandable for every kid in Berlin who has in school, in class, children from Islam community, and also vice versa.
And that is, the bigger question is, what difference does the sharing of knowledge and experiences of and by refugees make? Okay, so you can have a million digital apps, You can have a million websites, you can have social media, you can have an infinitely connected world in which every single refugee and migrant can share their experiences to the rest of the world, to the rest of Europe. My question is, what difference does that make? And I would say that in this age of digital saturation of information about crises, global conflict, economic, merging together and continuing, there is a disconnect between what was once understood as a certain amount of knowledge and a certain response. Okay, the classic work on media and conflict and audiences tells you that. And we haven't really got that. I don't think we've quite got that, that there is that disconnect, that, that these migrant experiences and diasporic memory can be shared at one level, helps migrants in some ways, but what difference does it ultimately make in terms of us, the rest of the world, in terms of doing anything about those crises? And so we need to think more, to answer your question, more innovatively. And it's not just digital solutions. So I'm working with an artist, I think social science and artists should work together, an artist, Mark Neville in London, an International Rescue Committee. We put a project forward that I think is going to go ahead of getting migrants to share experiences in different ways, but not in a digital way, but that will come together in a hard book that will be shared that has greater sustenance, greater longevity than a lot of the digital stuff that's floating around. It's just about rethinking, I think, the digital environment and thinking about more innovative ways in which we can get that information to policymakers and those people who make the decisions and make the differences. Because, you know, otherwise, I think we're on a train that really doesn't make much difference ultimately.
Okay, thank you very much. It's really unfortunate that we need to stop it here, but the coffee is waiting. But the good news is that this same conversation will continue in the panel 6 tomorrow. So how to help the refugees and migrants to connect better to the European cultural space more effectively. So come back tomorrow. And now for the coffee.